Okay, thank you everybody for attending. I'm going to talk about APIs in city mobility. I'm very happy to be here in Barcelona. Unfortunately, I have to leave right away again. I really like Barcelona and I would have loved the chance to do a little bit of sightseeing, but hopefully I'll be back. First, I want to discuss a little bit about why our customer needed APIs and why you need APIs in this space of public transport or transport in general. And then about who were involved. It's basically the bus company and eProcede. And how did we accomplish getting this API up and running, and where are we going next? So I'll talk a little bit about the technology under the cover, but it's going to be very brief. I think it's, as Ed was mentioning, it's not the most important part of an API, of course, but you do need the technology, otherwise API isn't doing anything. So in the Netherlands, we really have a huge traffic issue, especially in the west part of the country or in any city. And apparently, we are the second worst country in terms of traffic of Europe and the US. So everybody from government to bus companies to individuals are trying to solve that issue. And one of the ideas that live today is that instead of thinking about transportation as I need to take a bus or I'm going to take a train or I'm going to drive with my car, is to think about your trip. So for example, I don't know where you guys came from, but if you're coming from outside of Barcelona, you have to get from your home to this location, right? You don't really think about the transport mode. You think, I need to be here at a certain time. I don't want to be late. I don't want to run a chance of getting in a traffic jam. So I don't care about necessarily my train ticket or my car. I care about being here on time. So this concept is what is called mobility as a service, and it's often referred used as a sort of a solution for traffic jams and also for better experience for users. So now let me see if I can get this to play. I don't know if you can hear it. Oh, we don't have the sound. If we don't have sound, I'll just skip it. Basically, it explains that that we build a mobility as a service. Sorry? Partners.
As a result, travelers will be provided with a complete mobile door-to-door service based on their personal situation and real-time traffic information. Together, we created mobility as a service.
Well, the actual point was in the beginning, so we missed that, unfortunately. I'll explain it with text. It's a little bit more boring, but it's the same. Basically, if you look at mobility as a service, so thinking about your trip, instead of, I want to take a bus, or I'm going to take my car, or I'm going to take a taxi. Myself, I'll travel to San Francisco today, so I have a number of legs. But I just care about getting to the apartment that I rented through Airbnb. I don't care about how I get there. In the sense that I want to make a choice. So the advantage is if you have mobility as a service is that as a traveler, I can optimize based on preference. So for example, if I need to be at a conference or at a customer, I care about being on time. But when I'm doing it for my vacation, maybe I want to save some money on the trip, so I care about the cost. So depending on the trip I'm taking, I want to prefer one way or the other. Comfort can be important. Sometimes I want to work when I'm traveling, so the car is not an option because I cannot program and drive at the same time. People frown upon that, so I'd rather not do that. But, you know, sometimes I don't need to work, and so I can take a car. So for a traveler, it's nice to have an option and to make that option based on the trip you're doing, and not I buy myself a car, and that means I have to take the car every time because I bought the thing, right? So giving people options is the concept of mobility as a service. And also, I want to be able to change my mind. In the Netherlands, as I said, we have really, really bad traffic problems. So you might look in the morning, say, okay, it's fine, I can take the car and go to from Amsterdam to Utrecht, for example. But then halfway through, an accident happens. And I might change my mind, park my car, and take the train the rest of the trip. Or the other way around, also happens. When there's leaves on the rails, or there's snow or something, like a weather disaster happening in the Netherlands, then the trains don't run, then I want to be able to have an alternative while I'm traveling. And mobility as a service gives travelers the information that you need to make those changes and give the suggestions. So for the Dutch society, it's a good thing, because if not everybody owns a car and takes the car every day, we will have less traffic jams and less parking problems, and less pollution, of course. Now, we were doing this API platform for a bus company in the Netherlands. They are known under the brand Connection, but it's part of Transdev, which is a big company. I'm not sure they're in Spain, but I know that they're in France and Portugal, Finland. So they have a lot of buses driving around. And basically, of course, they like the fact that it helps society, but they also want to sell more bus tickets because they're a commercial company, right? So they want to sell more bus tickets. And they want to make sure that people can get to where they need to go and be happy and give them better information during the trip. So for them, it's also a very important way of getting people that normally don't take the bus in the bus, but also their current customers happier because they have the right information and they can make the right decision about what bus to take. If you go by bus every day and there's a detour or there's road work, it's nice to be informed. So there's definitely also a commercial reason, of course, for the public transport company. Now, that's all nice. I'm talking about mobility as a service, but we're here not at a public transport conference, right? So you guys might wonder, what does that have to do with APIs? And of course, all that I was saying really depends on the availability of the information. Now, a company like Connection or Transdev has a lot of information in their backend systems about routes, about detours, about cost of tickets, about buses, about whatever you can think of is sitting in systems in their back office that they use for their planning, that they use for the bus schedules and the shifts for the drivers. But it needs to be available for someone who's planning a trip. So an API, obviously, can make information available. The other thing you can see is that there's a huge growth in mobile phones still. And in the Netherlands, we have a lot of open data for public transport. So anybody can go to a website and download all the bus stops in the Netherlands and train stops that are there in a huge XML file. Now, I don't know if you ever build a mobile app, but it's not really nice to daily download a huge XML file, try to parse that to find the bus stops that you need, right? So it needs to be fit for mobile phones. So APIs are much better format than having huge XML files. And then, of course, if I'm planning my trip based on the information that I get, I want to make 100% sure that it's reliable and that I don't plan my trip based on information that's incorrect. It happened to me a couple of times that I would plan my trip with Google or some Dutch general service about bus schedules. I would be at the bus stop, and it was completely wrong. So I would be there for 15 minutes, which is annoying, but also it made me late for the next step of your trip. So it's really important that you can trust the information that you get. So that's why Connection feels if people know it's coming from the source, because it's their bus, that will give the reliability that you need for that. Also, access to information should be controlled in the sense that Connection also wants to sell the tickets. So they don't want anybody to just have access and then not pay for it, right? So they need to be paid for the bus tickets. And so they want to be able to control who can access what API. So some APIs are open, so anybody can look up bus stops. So there's an API right now where you can say, I'm right here, I'm standing in this auditorium, where is the nearest bus stop? That's open. Nobody, you know, don't need to register or something like that. But to generate a bus ticket, you need to have a contract with the bus company as a mobility provider. And so we need to differentiate between who can access what API, and we also want to know how many times do these third parties access our APIs. It should be secure, of course. We don't want people to hack it, to make it down, because then it's also no longer reliable. And it needs to be scalable. Connection feels this is really a huge market that will grow a lot. And when I was in Finland, it's actually already a law that each public transport company has to provide APIs to third parties to enable them to build their own apps. So it's very similar to PSD2, the banking standard, where all banks have to open up their APIs. In Finland, they made a similar law for public transport. And so pretty soon in Europe, you will see more and more public transport companies opening up their APIs, and more apps that will give you the option to plan a trip. So, and buy tickets, not just planning it, but also buying it. And the ecosystem is growing. Connexion also wants to cater for the last mile. So if you want to get here and there's no bus stop, maybe you want to get a bike, or you want to get a car, or you want to walk, but still you want to know everything, right? You want to get door to door. You don't care about getting to the bus stop. That's usually not your end location, right? Hopefully. Hopefully you want to go to somewhere, you know, other than the bus stop. So it's very important to have multiple parties give their information so you can combine that and plan an end-to-end trip. And it would centralize the access to the open data. So this was why Connexion said we need an API platform, because we cannot just put it out there. We need to have all these features. I already explained a little bit about them. It's a big company. This we did in the Netherlands. So in the Netherlands, they tried to do some innovation around that. And they're also thinking about having other APIs, not just the one for mobility as a service, because they also have ambulance and some other stuff. So a little bit about me and my company. We are based in Luxembourg. We have offices in several parts of the world, mostly EMEA, so Europe, Middle East, Africa. And the technology that we use under the cover, but that's not relevant for, of course, the consumers of the API, is Oracle. And basically, our services that we offer are support services for people's infrastructure type application support. And we do consultancy, and this was an example of a consultancy project. So we set up the API platform, we did the design, we did the realization of the APIs. We also built the business logic, connected it to the backend systems, and now we are supporting the platform to make sure it's available as needed. And we have a couple of products and solutions, mostly in the financial services area because of our location in Luxembourg. You can imagine we have a lot of banks as customers. Myself, I'm CTO at ePerceed and looking into innovation a lot. So this is also one of our more innovative projects that we did. And if you want to know more about me, then maybe we can talk about later. So, okay, if you look at the API platform that we built and we just saw what was needed by Transdev, then basically we had a couple of APIs. We had three APIs that we started with. And this was sort of on purpose, because we had one that is open, so anybody can ask for the next bus stop. It's no security there or anything. We had one to generate bus tickets that had a very clear business purpose to sell more bus tickets. And then we had an API was called Routes and Detours that was offered to drivers. So in the morning, they could visualize the route, and it would highlight the detours for them. Because they drive the same route often, it's useful to notify them of the detours. At least that was the assumption. Because one of the things that we really liked about the approach is that we started small and we tried the APIs. So I'll already tell you a little bit about the ending of the routes and detours. They did a test with the drivers. They put the device in the bus. It's like a navigational device. They did a test, but they weren't really impressed with what it brought them. So after that test with the mobile device, that API for the drivers was no longer used. However, we did publish it now for regular travelers, because when I take the bus every day to the train station or somewhere else, I might also be interested in detours. So even though the original consumer wasn't that interested, we now made it a generally available feature that can also be used by the mobility as a service providers. The industry, public transport, has a lot of standards. One of the biggest challenges is a lot of those standards have been around for a while, and they go into these standardization committees. I don't know if you have ever had the pleasure to be in the standardization committee. Has anybody been in one? Okay, stay away from them. It takes a long time, a lot of meetings, and you are always running a little bit behind the state of the art, because everybody has to agree and everybody has to be able to comply with it. So if you look at the standards that we had to adhere to be able to offer the information, for the detours, it had NetX, which is a standard for public transport. Again, it's big XMLs. It has everything. It has multiple layers. It has geolocation more for navigation. It has the geolocations, actual physical, where the streets are. It has journaling, so the original schedule, the change to the schedule. And so trying to work with that in an API is quite hard, and there's very little standards around mobility as a service established yet. They started one in the Nordics, so we're looking into that one again. Also for generating the barcode, so we use a QR code to generate a ticket. It also has old-fashioned standards where you have to do the fixed length fields and stuff like that. So it's not like we're all used to having a nice JSON object and put that in somewhere. You have to encode it in some old-fashioned standards. Now, what the API platform offers for the provider, for the connection, is they are able to secure it, they can publish it, they control the access, and they have insight in the use. And that is very important. Whenever we publish an API, we might think it's a very interesting API, but if nobody is actually using it, we are maintaining something that's a waste of money and effort and having connections up and running. So we see a lot that people are interested, they subscribe, and then nothing happens for months. And so what the API platform gives to them is that they have very good insight in who's actually in test doing stuff, who's not doing anything in production, so they did a lot in test, but then nothing happens in production, so they can reach out to their business partners and say, hey, I can see you were testing your mobile app a lot in November, now we put you in the production environment and we don't see anything. Are you not selling any tickets? Did you delay your go live, or what is happening there? So it gives them a lot of insight. And they're thinking about monetizing the APIs, like Ed was saying, in a model where you can pay per use. Right now, what is done is, at the end, they charge the third parties for the number of tickets sold. So they don't do it per API call. But they could do it with the platform. For the consumer side, so the third parties that have the door-to-door apps, the API platform offers a portal where they can find documentation for the API. There's also some SDKs, so they can generate some of the, you know, headers for the calls to the API. They can subscribe to it, and they can test it. And then, of course, in production, they can consume it. And for the API developers, so that was us, we can use the platform to develop and test and to do the troubleshooting and monitoring, because it gives insight to the business users. It also gives insight to us. We're supporting them. So for example, when somebody first time subscribes to an API, we can see, for example, a lot of errors in either the key that they need to send or the OAuth. So we can already anticipate we're going to get a support ticket asking help to explain how to connect to the OAuth. And so it's very useful for us that we can see what type of error messages they are getting. We don't see any of the actual messages. It's just the metadata about the type of errors that they're getting and where they are getting coming from. So the API platform was realized to support the mobility as a service and some other APIs. We did that together with the bus company. And so they needed the APIs for that. It has three major parts. So how did we realize that? So a little bit about the technical background there. Is for the business logic behind the different APIs, we used something that is called Oracle Mobile Cloud Service. It has connectors, so you can connect to an XML source, a SOAP service, or a REST service. And it has a number of location-based services. So the geocoding, for example, you can give it a coordinates, latitude and longitude, and then you can do geofencing and get all the bus stops within a certain area, and some other tooling. For the security, we use the Oracle Identity Cloud Service and the OAuth options that are there, and also for the user management. So any third party that requests access to the developer portal is stored in the Identity Cloud Service, and so we can also see who's logging on, and to make sure that nothing goes bad there. One of the things is because we have a number of different consumers, and they have people working for them, and then they leave the company, but they still have access, right? And you don't want that because it might actually, they might actually start using an API. So we have good overview of the usage of the platform, both from the developer portal perspective and the API management perspective. So you have an audit trail and reporting about that. Then there's a service, so it's a little bit a combination of different services in the Oracle platform that we use. It's called the API Platform Service. It offers the portal for the API management and the portal for the developers. And it handles all the security using a gateway node that you can see on the right. That is the runtime environment. So we have a load balancer there to make sure it's always up. And we deploy the APIs to that gateway. And the gateway will collect all the information about the usage and stuff like that. So to realize this API platform, these were the products that that we used. So here you can see a little bit of an overview. And I think with APIs, it's always interesting who is consuming it, right? So you have a person who needs to understand the API. You as a developer or as a product owner or an information analyst. So that you can see at the top. So you will access the API platform using a browser, going into the developer portal and look up documentation. The documentation is written in a tool, it's called Apiary. But of course, if you want, you could also use another tool for that. It gives you the option to also make sure it adheres to standards, it gives you mock services. So that developer, even before actually doing anything with the runtime APIs that are deployed, can already start testing, either with Postman or with their app in the Apiary platform, to make sure they understand how the API works. Because you're talking about transport and semantics, and those mobility as a service providers sometimes know a lot about cars and buses, trains, but not necessarily about bus terminology or vice versa. So it's good that they can test and try the API before they actually do anything in the runtime environment. So it gives you the mock. And then also the management portal you also access using a browser. So the bus company connection uses the management portal to look at the usage, for example, and to see how much the API platform is used. And us as developers do that as well for the troubleshooting. We use the browser. Now that's one part of the consumers, that's us humans. But then of course we have the apps. So right now we have the two mobility as a service apps that are live and selling connection bus tickets in their app. So you could go to the bus store, to the app store and download, for example, Wim or GoAbout. I'm not sure whether they're already active in Spain. I know that they are doing this in different cities in Europe. And then the SIS was the driver information system. And those access the APIs using the gateway node where all the security is being taken care of. And then if everything's okay, it will go to where the actual code is running in the mobile cloud service. Now this is a little bit outdated because we are now further. So this was the first version of our APIs and also of the portal. How it looks like. So at the left, you can see the management portal, and you can see that you can there define your security policies on the APIs you want to apply. So you can also do traffic management. The platform you pay by number of messages that you're sending. So you don't want people to just starting to send you thousands and thousands of test messages a day, right? So what you can do is you can limit the amount of messages somebody can send per hour. And you could use also use that as a sort of pricing model, where you say, okay, it's free if you do less than, 500 per hour. If you start using more than 500 per hour, you have to subscribe to another one and you'll have to pay for that, right? So the traffic management, you can combine that to monetize your API. Right now, that's not used for that. We mainly use it to make sure that the bus company doesn't have to pay a lot for their platform unexpectedly because somebody is doing a lot of calls accidentally, creating some endless loop or doing some performance testing without us knowing it. So you can limit that. And then you can also do routing. And so you can say, I want to send this payload to this type of consumer, but less information to other types of consumers, because sometimes you might have privacy-sensitive information, for example. So this, in this management portal, you can configure that and then deploy it to the gateway. Now, when you're a developer, you look at the right side of it. So that's your developer portal. You can subscribe to the APIs over there, and then you can go and look into the documentation. You can try and use the API, and then you can subscribe to a plan. And the plans, then you can have different plans with APIs and see what you can pay. And I think for us it was nice that you can see that because of the developer portal, we get relatively little questions from developers about the APIs, because it's fairly self-explanatory, right? You have the API in Swagger or in the format of Apiary. You can test it, you can run it already, so you don't have to answer a lot of the, you know, starting questions. The questions will start to come up when people are actually using it. Does this really fit my use case, and can you help me with something that's maybe a little bit more challenging from a technical perspective, like the OAuth? So now that you know why we did the APIs and with whom we did that and how we built them, let's take a little look at the APIs that we started with. So the first one was a barcode or QR code API, or a sales API, or a ticket generation API. I think it's one of the hard things, just as a sidestep. We designed this API as a sales API because it sells tickets. The customer calls it a barcode API, but it's actually a QR code. And so when we talk about this API, it's confusing because they sell it to their business partners, and then they go into the developer portal and they are trying to look for the API, but because the naming and the semantics are a bit different, it's I think hard to come up with a name that is understandable both for the ones providing the API. Because for connection, it's extremely relevant that it's a barcode, because all of their other tickets have a different format, right? They have either a card or a paper ticket. But for the consumer of the API, yeah, they need to know that in the end you get a barcode, but they are interested in getting, you know, a valid ticket for a part of a trip. So having the perspective of the two match is not that easy. We used a couple of libraries for to generate the barcode. And I think from a technical perspective, as I said, the standards in the transport world are quite outdated, and we were using Node.js, and so we were struggling a lot to make sure that we could use the ISO character set, and Node, since it's JavaScript, always very nicely changes your data types for you, so we had some struggling with that. So in the end, we wrote a little Java program because it's strongly typed and it doesn't do all that type conversion under the covers to test our result to make sure it actually works. And we used OAuth for that, because there we don't want anybody to get a ticket because you have to pay for it. So you have to have a contract with Connection to be able to sell the tickets. And the first two that went live is GoBout and Wim, and so you can see the version of the app at the time. I didn't check lately, so that might look different, of course, now. But you can see there that you can plan your trip and you buy in another app, not a Connection app, a Connection ticket, and you can take a trip and put the barcode in the barcode reader in the bus. And maybe as an interesting story, the first test we did, they didn't have any barcode readers in the bus. Because what they wanted to do is make sure that everything works. Setting up this API in the platform was not a lot of work. It's all in the cloud. So in 6 weeks, we had it live. But to get all the barcode readers in the bus, that actually takes months. And it's expensive, right? You put the reader in the bus. If it's installed wrong, you have a big problem in terms of pricing. So we started doing this. Travelers would just wave the barcode at the driver. He would say, okay, enjoy your trip, and just to test if that process worked. And then when that worked, they started testing the barcode readers outside of a bus, and now they're actually in the bus, and we can actually read it. And it was actually the biggest challenge is to make sure the readers understand the QR code, because the lighting of your mobile phone often interferes the reflection. So the API part was actually easy. The physical part in this case was quite hard. Another thing that we did was the stopping places. I was telling you about it, the daily synchronization. It's actually interesting, nobody's using this API, so we build it, but it's not used at all, so it's still there. We had some challenges about geocoding and the way that coordinates were stored in the XML file was a different coordinate system than the latitude longitude system that you're used to. But it works, and it's there, with zero consumers. And then we had the driver information system. So this was what they put in the bus, but before they put that, well, they put it in one bus, it wasn't really valued by the bus drivers, so they didn't install it in any of the other buses. But we are offering that now as a public API, and we have some interest for the mobility as a service builders, because they want to tell their customer, when you bought a bus ticket, hey, pay attention because you planned this trip, but there's a detour or a delay or whatever. So it's going to be used for something else. Here we had to learn GraphQL because the source of the data was in GraphQL, and it was very complicated data. So I learned a lot, and happily, I'm happy to say I also forgot it again about all the data structures that were behind all those schedules. Because scheduling and buses and locations is quite complicated. But we transformed that into something that is very easily consumable by a mobile app. So you don't have to know all that stuff to use this API. You can just ask, what is the detour on this route, on this line, on this destination? Instead of having to go through all the schedules and trying to figure out what the exact detour will be for you. So what did we learn when we built this API platform? It was new for the bus company, and it was also new for us. I think what is very important is to start small like we did. Like I was saying, we started with three APIs. They were all live in 6 weeks. And it's part of an ecosystem, right? It's one thing to build it, but then the people will have to start using it. And that takes longer. And we have a lot of consumers with very different maturity. So some of the mobility as a service parties like Wim and GoAbout, they're very mature and they understand REST APIs, they understand OAuth, they expect certain things from us. But sometimes we get parties that are also new to the area and their maturity levels are much lower, and so they need way more help. And so building this ecosystem and improving your documentation, you keep doing that. So even though this has been live now for almost a year and a half, we are still updating our documentation. When new consumers start asking questions, we go, oh, maybe we should write that somewhere, because apparently it's not that obvious for everybody. Right now, we have an option to download the API blueprint or a Swagger. OpenAPI version 3 is coming. It's hard. Everybody uses something else. So I'm really hoping everybody will go to OpenAPI 3, and then we get rid of all those different ways of describing APIs, because it's giving me a headache. I don't know about you guys, but I would really, really, really like it if everybody would use the same. The OAuth, we get so many questions. It's a standard, but every single OAuth implementation has different types of fields. There's different flows that you can implement. So we added it to the documentation, even though it's a standard. And of course, you always have your versioning strategy. That's not specific to APIs. In any integration, you'll have versions, I think. And right now, we have a policy. We support two versions. There's people live in production, so they stay on the version. When we have new functionality, a new version is published. And then we tell the other consumers, OK, you have to migrate within a, you know, we usually give them a time period of a couple of weeks to the new version so that we can get rid of the other one. So we're now in version 3, and I'm very happy to say that we got rid of version 1. So that is so far working really well, but it's costing a lot of effort in convincing the consumers, because obviously they don't always want to. If they like the new feature, then they will, but sometimes it's a new feature for another consumer, so they are not really inclined to change. But so far, that's working really nicely. So what is next? Well, in general, this whole sales channel is very successful for them. They are divided in different areas, so they drive buses in Schiphol, in Eindhoven, in different areas, and now all the marketing people are starting to sell that to different of their customers, so it's growing. They're going to do the online validation of the tickets. Right now, if you put your barcode underneath the reader, it checks it with the local bus data, which is of course outdated. If you have a 10-trip ticket, that bus doesn't know how many tickets you made before that, so they're going to do online validation. And we are adding multiple other providers. And we're now combining it also with events. So we did one with the soccer game. So you go to a soccer game, Ajax, or I'm more a PSV fan, but okay, I'll sell the ticket for Ajax as well. So you do that, and then you can buy the bus ticket in one go, and you have the barcodes both for the event and for your bus ticket on the same page, so to speak. And they're also talking to other parties, like Booking, right? Right now, if you do booking.com, it says, do you want to rent a car? But what Connection wants is that those types of sites will also offer you to take a bus instead of always offering cars. But they're also talking to some rental companies to add their offerings to it so that the mobility as a service provider can get it from them. And they want to start adding more services for the travelers. So if you take the bus 10 times in a month, the 11th time is going to be cheaper. They call that account-based traveling. And dynamic pricing. So if you buy the ticket for after 9, it will be cheaper than before 9, for example. So those are one of the things, a couple of things that they are doing to expand now with the new API platform that they have running. And so we are going to have some more fun with it, I think. It has, for us, been a very interesting project. I guess that's it.